Welcome to Rouse Eye Study Circle, Chandrima.
Thank you so much, sir. My pleasure.
I should be saying welcome back because you have been a GS student of Rouse.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so it's a pleasure to meet you again, Chandrima.
Thank you, sir.
Chandrima, you would be aware that in the environment there is a lot of advisors, talks about topper's talk, as they commonly we say it, about the students, guiding the students who are already in the foray of civil services, who are preparing, who are in the grind. I would like to discuss with you about, aiming towards the students, aspirants who are wanting to start preparing for CSE, who have just completed their 12th and now starting with graduation, and alongside graduation, they are wanting to prepare for civil services.
Yes.
So let me begin by asking you the first question. What was your motivation to try for civil services?
Yes, sir. So initially, when I was in my 6th and 7th standard, I had heard from my parents and from my grandparents that there is this career wherein you can become an officer and you can serve the society in some capacity. But at that point of time, I did not have the concrete idea, as with every beginner, as to what this service entails and what kind of preparation it requires and how grueling it is and how you should go about it. So all those things were unclear in my mind. Then as I grew, as I entered 10th standard, 11th standard, I was unclear about my goal. I did not know in which stream I would like to make a career. I considered medical, I considered non-medical, I considered humanities. So I had a general interest in science at that time. So I thought that let me study science till 12th standard. So that was my only a reason behind taking medical, as in biology, as well as mathematics.
Yes.
Because I was not clear which stream to go into, but I knew that I had an interest in science. So I took up both these subjects till 12th standard. Then afterwards, I wanted to explore myself. I wanted to have an exposure so as to become clear about my goals. So that dream that I saw in 6th, 7th standard, it went back somewhere back in my mind, and I was not able to realize it in my 11th, 12th, or in my graduation days. So at that time also, when I entered college, I thought that St. Stephen's College is a very good college, very reputed one, and it will provide me good opportunities to explore myself so as to become clear about my goal in life, about my dream in life. So that was my primary motivation to go in St. Stephen's College. So as to explore myself, there is a liberal arts college, there are extracurricular activities, it's in Delhi, so you can have exposure to other activities in Delhi. So that was my prime motive. I did not have any idea about the civil services or if I want to go for civil services or not. So that was again in the back burner. Then when I entered college, I participated in a lot of activities in Social Service League of our college. That is a society which organizes various events such as blood donation camps. And I also taught the kids of the workers in our college in the evening classes that used to be held in our college. So that was my one activity. Then I visited many orphanage homes. I visited many shelter homes in Delhi. So at that point in time, I realized that my inclination lies towards social service or towards something which contributes to the society. So at that time, I made up my mind that, okay, civil services is one platform, one career opportunity wherein I could have a positive impact on people around me and where I would derive personal satisfaction from my work. Because I'd already experienced satisfaction while working for the Social Service League in our college. So that motivation aroused in me in my college days. And in the third year of my college, I made up my mind that I will prepare for civil services exam.
So Chandrima, when you took physical science,
yes,
in Stephens, that time you had not taken this stream with the point of view of appearing for civil services exam.
Right, sir. Because my main subject in the course was chemistry. And I my favorite subject in 11th and 12th was chemistry. So I thought, okay, in graduation, I will be able to study chemistry for 3 years because I like the subject. So I went ahead with the course and I got enrolled in that. But civil services as a career did not come to my mind at that point of time. Hmm. Yes.
All right. So it is only after reaching the college that you decided, when you got exposed to the social service, you realized, yes, that this is what you want to do in life.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Chandrima, as I mentioned when we were talking yesterday, the aspirants who are wanting to become, get into civil services, from postgraduates to graduates, are now shifted towards people who have just passed 12th class and who are wanting to, you know, prepare for civil services along with the graduation. Mm-hmm. So in your view, what do you think is the right time for someone to start preparing for civil services? Like, you realized it after joining college.
Yes, sir.
Do you think it is prudent today that a student who is from 12th class starts, you know, he gets going in the beginning itself with the graduation?
So it varies for different people. Some people, they gain clarity in the early years of their childhood. They become very clear that this is their goal. And some people, they take a lot of time to become clear about their goal. So there is nothing right or wrong about it. It's your personal call. If you think that your why should be very clear and strong in your mind, your why do you want to become a civil servant should not come from any external pressure, any external parental pressure or peer pressure or any kind of external influence. You should have an intrinsic motivation to become a civil servant. That those reasons that you have for becoming civil servant, that should be your own reason and not the reason which is imported into your mind by any kind of pressure from the outside. So when you gain that kind of clarity regarding anything, whether it's in your schooling days or in your graduation days or post-graduation days, then it is fine to start your preparation. But I would say that you should not become too burdened at the initial stages, say in school days or in college days, because at that time, it's very important that your foundation is also strong, in the sense that your education is not hampered, your extracurricular activities, your hobbies, these things should not be sacrificed at the altar of preparation in the serious way. But yes, you should think about it when you have the goal. You should see other toppers who are achieving their goals, take inspiration from them, learn about the exam, learn what is required in the exam. So all this initial beginning can be made, but don't take it too seriously at the initial stages. You can build certain skills at that time. For instance, answer writing skill is one skill which is very important in the examination. Hmm. So you can build your answer writing skills in college days.
Yeah.
For instance, practicing writing or writing journals, diary writing, writing essays. So that thing you could start at that time. And also your speaking skills, your social skills, your communication skills. You could participate in debating. You can participate in other activities. Right. You should build your skills. Hmm. And newspaper is one thing which you can start even at the school level. If you are reading newspapers in school days, since college days, so your mental scope is broadened, and till the time you start seriously preparing for civil services, your knowledge base will be already very wide and extensive in range if you read the newspapers properly. So these small things you can continue and you can manage with your college studies. But serious preparation, again, I would say it requires one complete year with complete focus and dedication if you want to attempt next year. So that is my personal experience.
Now, this dilemma most of the students face who are from science and commerce background.
Yes.
When they are about to start their graduation, they are now wondering, and their focus is clear that they want to do CSE.
Yes.
The question is, should they take now humanities stream or they keep sticking to their science or commerce stream?
Yes.
Do you think that humanities streams will give a little edge to the students in CSE?
So in my personal experience that I have faced, I think choosing your optional subject is very, very important. It can make or break your chances. So whatever optional that you're selecting, you should be very, very comfortable with it. And you should have confidence in it that if I take this optional, I'll be able to score good marks. So first of all, I would advise everyone to see the list of the optional subjects that the UPSC provides and shortlist two or three subjects that they find that they can study. And then out of those two, three subjects, they look at their syllabus, look at the past year question papers, look at the coaching that is available and talk to some of the teachers that are teaching those subjects. And after this entire thorough research, only then you select your optional subject. For science and commerce graduates, some people who are again comfortable in their graduation subject, they opt for their graduation subject as their optional subject. So that gives them a certain advantage over others because they've already studied that optional for 3 years in their graduation. If you take that, then it's your personal call. If you're comfortable in your graduation subject, go for it. No harm in that. But for others who are not so comfortable and who feel that they have lost touch with it or they are not enjoying it now, so for them, then the trick that I have told just now, shortlist 2-3 subjects, yeah. Go through their syllabus, see the past papers, see the topper strategy, talk to teachers, and then decide on one subject.
All right.
Yes, sir.
You have gone through the grind 4 times.
Yes, sir.
So tell us, Chandrima, what does actually IAS exam really test in a candidate? Right from prelims, mains, and then finally the personality test. What are they looking for in a candidate?
So first of all, it tests your, in my opinion, it tests your entire personality and your character traits. Right from the beginning. Apart from your aptitude, which includes your analytical skills, your reading skills, your writing skills. So that comes in your aptitude. But the other aspect is your emotional intelligence, your mindset, your thinking. So all those things are very personal to everybody. So if suppose in the first attempt, you're not able to clear your pre or your mains, or in the next 2-3 attempts, you're not able to clear pre itself. It happens with a lot of people. So at that time, your mindset and your emotional quotient, your perseverance, your patience, so those things become very important. So if you are someone who becomes too negative or who becomes too flustered or demotivated or disheartened and takes it in an overwhelming way, then you will lose your next attempt also, because then your preparation will suffer.
Yeah.
So these qualities are required if one is thinking of clearing this exam, and one must be very patient with oneself and with the entire process as well.
Do you think there is a requirement of mugging in this?
Some mugging, so a little bit, yes, I won't lie, because in prelims especially, you have to mug certain facts, because sometimes prelims, very directly, they ask factual questions. And in mains also, in while doing answer writing, you have to supplement your answers with data, yeah. With certain data, with certain committee report, certain recommendations. So there a little mugging up is required. But if it does not has that understanding, which is the basic foundation
conceptually
of
you
conceptual
need to
clarity,
yeah.
Then you will not be able to sew one fact with the other fact. So for that, you need clarity and understanding. So understanding is the basic building block. And mugging up is required just to enhance your answer so as to, you know, show, it looks more knowledgeable, looks more refined, and the examiner thinks that you have studied a lot for this examination. So that part is indeed a part of this process.
Yeah. Chandrima, when a beginner starts with, you know, starts looking at UPSC syllabus, it looks like a endless ocean. I mean, you don't know where to start and where to end. So how do you stick yourself within the confines of the UPSC syllabus? How do you prepare? How do you interlink the syllabus of one vertical with the another one?
Yes, sir. So this is another query, but some people think that every pre is different or mains is different and interview is different, but this is a wrong perspective.
Mm-hmm.
All the three parts of the examination are interlinked. If you are studying for prelims, you also have to study, you are studying simultaneously for mains as well, because in mains also there's overlap of syllabus. So one has to understand this point, that all the three stages of the examination are linked. And if you want to attempt, you cannot think that, okay, in this attempt, I will clear only prelims or I will clear only mains. Mm. You have to be sure in your mind that whatever attempt you're giving, you will get a good rank. That should be your ultimate goal, getting a good rank. So when you think in that way, your entire strategy from the beginning will be very sorted and very interlinked. So that is one point. And so other thing is for prelims, especially because I failed 2 prelims back to back. So I understood that prelims actually requires a checklist. So if you follow that checklist, then you can be assured that your prelims will be cleared, that you will be in the safe zone. For instance, if you read the standard books, which is mentioned for every subject. If you give 2 test series, all the mock tests of any 2 coaching test series, then you will be in the safe zone, because then you will have a lot of practice beforehand.
Mm.
And if you read current affairs extensively, So these simple points are there, and if you check that box one after the other for prelims, then you can be assured that you will land in the safe zone. Most of the times people don't take tests seriously, people don't cover the syllabus, and then they cry that prelims is uncertain or it is very dicey or kuch bhi aa jata hai prelims mein. But this is a wrong thing, because if you are doing everything which is required, then even if you don't score too high in prelims, you will be assured ki cutoff limit se you will be 10 to 15 marks ahead if you follow that checklist. So for prelims, I devised this strategy only. I revised in the last 2 months. I gave a lot of mock tests for one per day. I used to give 2 GS mock tests, and simultaneously I used to see where I'm doing negative marking. I used to analyze my mistakes, and I used to ensure that in the next mock test, I do not repeat the same mistakes which I made in the last mock test. So a lot of practice and revision and completing the entire syllabus, then reading a lot of current affairs from monthly magazines of coaching, and also supplementing it with my newspaper notes. So all these things were very useful, and they ensured that I cleared the prelim stage. For mains, sir, syllabus is very, very important, because for mains, for every paper, you have the predetermined syllabus. So I had pasted those syllabus on my walls throughout the year that I was preparing, and I used to refer to that syllabus whenever I was making notes or whenever I was studying anything for mains. For paper 1, 2, 3, some of the parts are common with pre, for instance history, geography, polity and economy. So those things will be covered while you are studying for pre. No need to read for that part anything extra material. But for some additional topics, like in paper 1, you have society, you have world history, and in paper 2 you have IR and your political parties, your governance part. In paper 3 you have disaster management, internal security. These things are in addition to what you have studied for prelims. So in those things you make your own notes. So I had made notes for every mains topic, and I had revised those notes before my actual main examination. So in that way I completed my syllabus, and I made notes, I revised from them. Again, answer writing practice for mains is very, very crucial. From prelims till mains, every day you have to write at least 2 questions in your notebook at home, and you have to join test series for every, I joined test series for every paper, essay, GS papers, and optional. So test series is again very, very crucial in enhancing your score.
Okay, Chandrima, while you were talking about the syllabus, I was reminded of the NCERT books. The foundation of UPSC exam is NCERT books.
Yes, sir.
So a 12th class pass out, again I come back to the same point, should he start studying NCERT books from 6th onwards?
Yes, sir. If one is starting after 12th, then one has enough time to go about the preparation, and they can start with the NCERTs. When I was in my third year of college, when I had joined Rahul, then I studied a lot of NCERTs at that time, because I thought that in my college days I should make this a part of the examination, very solid in my preparation. So I had completed almost all of my NCERTs in my third year of college itself. So after that, I did not go back to those NCERTs. I referred only to the 11th and 12th NCERTs after that. But in college, I started from the 6th standard because I had enough time.
Okay. And you also mentioned about notes of yours. Do you think notes making is an essential requirement while you're preparing for civil services?
Yes, sir. Sir, in my opinion, it is very, very crucial. Because there is a lot of syllabus that you have to cover, and there are a lot of topics. If you do not make notes, then you will not have any idea as to which topic you have covered and which is left. So it is basically to consolidate your entire reading, and so that you can revise at the end of the time when you have little time left, you can get back to the notes and revise properly. If you don't make notes, then everything is in the air then. Then if you have read and you have not made notes, you cannot go back. I cannot go back to Lakshmikant and open and read every chapter again. So I had made very, very short and crisp notes, not more than one page for every topic. So on one topic, only one page, not more than that.
Okay.
So that the main keywords, they remain in my mind and I'm able to use them in my answers. So note making was very beneficial for my preparation.
Okay. As you were evolving in your process of preparing for the exam from 2015 onwards, Did you make some changes in your preparation strategy, which eventually materialized in 2019?
Yes, sir. So for me in this attempt, the most important game changer was my discipline and the routine that I imbibed in my preparation. Because earlier what I was doing was I was studying law also in between, because I was managing my preparation with law. And I was also attending some of the classes for my optional. So I could not devote that much time to self-study and to my own preparation. So in this year, in this attempt, 2018 to 2019, when I had a year off, I did not join any classes. Because I had already finished my optional classes and GS classes also I had done. So I took a year off. I focused only on self-study and I focused on answer writing practice. So these two things were the game changer for me in this attempt. And I made a routine for myself. I disciplined myself. I changed my habits. I used to stay late at night, and then I changed to sleeping at 10 p.m. and waking up at 5 a.m. and incorporated other good habits like exercising, going for a walk, and meditation. So all these little things, they improve my daily efficiency. So earlier I was studying, but I was not studying in a proper disciplined and consistent manner. But in this attempt, I was more consistent with my daily targets. And I had a plan and a strategy. So if I had a plan, then those plans, they made it easier for me to cover my syllabus in a timely manner. So I think these small tools and, you know, kicking your bad habits out and bringing new habits in, this really makes a very great amount of difference in your preparation. And I think everybody should improve themselves and incorporate more good habits in their life.
Okay, you mentioned about making plans and strategy and you were sticking to this timetable. Now, for any ordinary student who is preparing, you know, you make a plan, okay, by this date, I will complete my medieval history, by this ancient, and you know.
Yes.
But these slippages do take place. I mean, you yes. are going from one part of your schedule to another part. And
yes, sir.
So did you face this problem?
Yes, sir. So I think that nobody has a perfect preparation in this process. Even the rank one will say that I left these topics. All the toppers, they will tell you that they have also skipped some of the topics, or they have also skipped many deadlines. So nobody is perfect in their preparation. But if you give your best, then you can be sure that you will land among the toppers. So what matters is giving your best. And if the slippages happen, then you compensate them by doing what you think that will increase your chances of selection. So it's a game of loss and profit. It's a game of compensation. While you're doing something less, then do something more in the other subject. So it's a very balanced, you have to be very balanced in your preparation. You cannot overdo or underdo any of the things. Yeah. So that is something which is required.
When you were talking, you mentioned that you need to kind of embellish your answers with a lot of statistics, figures, and
yes,
a lot of information. What sources of information did you put your focus on while you were preparing?
So the main element in your answer should be your conceptual clarity. If that is lacking in your answer, then no matter how many data, figures, flowcharts, diagram you add, you will not get good marks. Because if the analysis is lacking, then your answer is a very incomplete and very shallow answer.
Yeah.
So first of all, you need to incorporate analytical skills. If any issue is asked, you have to mention the pros, the cons, what are the issues in implementation. Then you have to give your own suggestions or any committee suggestions, how the situation can be improved. Then you have to conclude the answer by a forward-looking suggestion. So all these things are important. Then to make it more refined, you can add data and other information. For instance, in the introduction of the answer, I used to give certain data. For instance, if the question is on urbanization, then I used to mention that India's this much population is living in the urban areas. Or if the question is on renewable energy, then I used to give the share of different sources of renewable energy in the total renewable mix. Like solar is this, wind energy this much percentage, hydrothermal this much percentage. So this kind of introduction I used to have in my answers. I used to add certain data in my introduction. Then in the body, I used to analyze the complete issue. For instance, if the NPA's problem is asked, then I used to give a certain introduction to the problem itself, when it began, how it began, what are the reasons for the problem. Then I used to mention what are the steps taken by the government, what are the steps taken by the RBI. So like that, I used to analyze the issue from the complete angle, from all the angles that it is possible. And in between that analysis, I used to incorporate diagrams of flow charts, if it is possible and if it does not break the flow of the answer. For instance, if I have to show reasons for the NPAs, so I used to make a circle, write NPAs, and then show reasons, and then label them properly. So it's very small and it comes naturally when you practice answer writing. It's nothing very difficult. And then after all this, I used to, in my conclusion, I used to give my suggestions. I used to mention a committee or a panel which is formed by the government. For instance, for banking reforms, Narasimhan committee, or for your political reforms, you can mention law commission also. For second ARC, you can mention Niti Aayog panel. So in conclusion, I used to, while giving suggestions, I used to mention any panel or committee which is formed by the government. And it's one or two suggestions that it has given to improve the situation. And then I used to conclude my answer like that.
Okay. Now, there are a lot of aspirants, as we talked, who are wanting to start with the preparations. What are your tips for those students who are now beginning their journey for civil services?
First of all, I would say that for those who are beginning their preparation journey, they should first understand the nature of the exam. That is very, very important. Don't just start reading before understanding what the exam demands, actually. So if you just start reading out of the sources, you confuse yourself a lot. It happened with me also. I did not plan properly. I did not strategize in my initial attempts. So I was just reading a lot of things, but those things were not making me clear the exam, because I did not have a plan or a strategy as to my daily targets, my weekly, monthly targets, and then my practice. Practice was also lacking in my earlier attempts. So those who are starting, please do not rush into the process. Take your time, build your strategy, listen to what the other toppers are saying, learn from their mistakes, and find what is suitable for you. If you think you need classes, then only go for classes. Don't go into the herd mentality of joining a coaching class and then not studying the entire year and just attending classes. So for those who are entering, understand your strengths and weaknesses, understand the nature of the exam, choose your optional subject wisely, and form your own strategy, which should include reading and covering the syllabus, and also a lot of practice, because practice will be a key difference between you and the person who is not selected, because everybody reads a lot, but only few people practice a lot. So you should not sacrifice practicing answers and practicing mock tests to read a lot of things and just to, you know, have that information. So don't collect too much information, practice a lot.
All right. Chandrima, finally, you are aware that the prelims have got postponed now, they are in October. Anything you want to tell the students who are appearing for prelims?
Yes, sir. So first of all, I would like to tell them that these are very tough times and it is happening with everyone. So do not be overwhelmed. Continue to make your efforts on a daily basis and talk to your near and dear ones, your friends, family, so that you have the right support, because in COVID times, you're not able to go out also. So in these times, it is very important for people to stay connected with their family and friends. And regarding preparation, I would say that in the last 2 months now, August and September are the only months remaining. October 4 is the prelim. So focus more on giving tests and focus more on revising instead of reading a lot of information now. Whatever you have read till now is sufficient. And if you give a lot of tests and revise them, then you will be able to score a good sufficient marks in prelim and you'll be able to sail through. So this is something that all of you should do right now.
And while we were talking, another question came to my mind. What do you think should be a number of questions which one should attempt to, you know, be in the safe zone in prelims?
Yes, sir. Even I did a lot of tests to find this optimum number for myself, because it's up to you how you attempt the paper. I cannot give you a short number of questions that you have to attempt to clear the pre. It's different for everybody. Some people have very high accuracy rate. So they attempt 90, above 90 questions and they clear prelims because their accuracy is very good. And some people, their accuracy is not that good. So for them, I would say that you attempt on the lower side. So it depends on you ultimately. What I did was I attempted a lot of tests, and in those tests, I analyzed how many number of questions is good for me to clear the cutoff. So based on my performance, I found out that number. So it depends on everybody. They have to decide for themselves what the optimum number of questions is. For that, you have to give tests. You have to analyze your mistakes. You have to see where you are going wrong. And then based on that, you have to find this optimum number.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sure that this advice will be very prudent for the aspirants who are now appearing for prelims.
Yes.
Thank you very much once again, Chandrima, for taking out time from your busy schedule and talking to us. And I'm sure the students who will be viewing this will definitely benefit from your talk.
Thank you so much.
And all the best, and wish you many more laurels in the future too.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.